Let's change gear, Chris, Michaela. Let's talk about waders.
Why not?
Abrupt change of gear. What are waders? Dictionary defines them as long-legged birds that live near water. Now, we have started to film waders on Unus here. There's some areas here that are absolutely fantastic for them. Let's have a look at where the waders are, where we've been filming them. There they are. That camera's sweeping over where we are and down there to those glorious flats, those salt flats. Lots of lovely mud there. Loads and loads of stuff for the birds to feed on. Now, what are the most common waders down there? Well, let's have a look at some of the birds that we've been filming. Here we go. A beautiful lapwing. And here's a... what is it, Chris?
A redshank.
I completely went out of my mind. My mind went completely blank. A redshank. The most common wader in the UK. Lapwing, absolutely beautiful. Look at that lovely crest.
Now, lapwings are one of the birds that are in serious decline. They've really plummeted, more than 50% in a 10-year period. And they do struggle to look after their young. When they hatch, all sorts of things have got their eyes on them. We saw this earlier. These are actually oyster catchers attacking a red kite. Now, red kites will take small prey, such as wader chicks, and eventually the lapwings join in, and all the waders down on the marsh drive this bird away very, very quickly. But perhaps a more serious predator, a more persistent predator of the waders, particularly when they're young like this. This is a young lapwing, possibly only a couple of days out of the egg by the looks of it, still being looked after by the adult there, and two of them. And their strategy, if they get spotted, is normally to freeze or make for some cover. But the animal I was talking about that's a persistent predator is this, the carrion crow. And look, the lapwings here have spotted a crow out on the marsh. And it's not just the pair that have got chicks there. They do this communal attacking of the crow. But listen to it. It's a magical sound. A magical sound, and it did the trick, because the crow was long gone.
Well, they obviously did do the trick, because take a look at these chicks. They're a little bit older now. They might not be those exact ones. But there we go. We've got an older redshank still looking quite cute. And I think we've also got an older lapwing. And they're hoping that this is going to be a good year on the reserve. With luck, they're hoping that the 44 pairs that they've got will be able to breed one chick each. So it could be a good year here on the reserve.
And of course, as soon as they're adults, they'll be facing a different type of predator. And Iolo Williams has been looking at just that down in Wales. It's our peregrines.
Welcome back to Bath, where the wind has let up a little bit now, so has the rain, but I came to Bath expecting sunshine. This is Welsh weather. What is going on? But it doesn't matter, because we've been entertained by our peregrine falcons. And I wanted to show you something that our cameraman filmed yesterday, showing what happens when a potential predator gets a little bit too close to the nest. Look at this. Now, we know that peregrines have been nesting here in Bath since 2006 and doing rather well, but other birds have moved in, namely gulls, especially herring gulls and lesser black-back gulls. Now, they're declining in their traditional coastal areas, but very much on the increase in our towns and cities, and this brings them into potential conflict with peregrines. Don't forget, these are big birds, almost the size of a buzzard. So what happens when one of them pushes their luck? Well, I warn you to watch carefully. This is over very, very quickly. Here we go. Bang! Did you see that? I think it's a young herring gull. We've slowed it down here. Look at that. Bear in mind, it's going at speeds of up to 100 miles an hour. It takes a chunk out of the back of that gull, but no harm done. It's not prey, just teaching it a lesson. Then the peregrine goes back up and perches and looks rather smug up there, if I may say so. And look at that, isn't that fantastic? That peregrine must be about half the size of that gull. Now, we've enjoyed some very intimate insights into peregrine life here, thanks to our nest cam way up there. We've seen the eggs hatch, we've seen the chicks grow, and we've seen our young male helping out as best he can too. And I know that you've enjoyed it at home, because we've had an incredible reaction saying that you've enjoyed the real big close-ups. So we thought we'd take advantage of this and show you some of the adaptations that a peregrine has to a fast life on the wing. This is something that was shot earlier, because our chicks are actually fast asleep now, I think. But earlier on, they were very alert. Here they are, look, 5 weeks old. And look at those eyes. See that? That eyelid moving across a third eyelid is called a nictitating membrane. It's a long, hard word, and their eyesight is superb. They can see 9 times better than we can. And look also at the nostril or the seer. You see there's a conical device in there, like a baffle, that slows down the wind speed when that bird is diving so that the wind doesn't rush into the lungs and burst those lungs. And the nictitating membrane, of course, protects the eye as well. But also we need to look at the killing machines, the talons. Here they are. Look at that. Bright yellow talons. And the beak, too. The beak is for ripping up prey more than anything else. And that's the ptomial tooth, that little notch there. That can distinguish falcons from hawks and eagles. Look at that. Close-up of peregrines like you will never see again. The big thing, of course, is what happens to our peregrines now. Well, we know that they are going to fledge in roughly a week, so we're going to leave a cameraman here to film that. But after that, well, they stay in this immediate vicinity for 2 or 3 weeks or so, maybe a little bit longer, but they won't be kicked out to this area by the adult birds until the end of the summer. And that's when they have to set up their own territories. They don't usually breed till they're about 2 years old. Our young adult male here, he's an exception, helping out, of course. And it'll be interesting to see what happens. This is all new research because urban peregrines, well, they've only been nesting in our towns and cities for about 30 years or so. But these have become real celebs too. Lots of people coming here to see them. But for now, from the Bath peregrines, from me and the team, it's back up to Ynys here in Wales.
Thanks, Iolo. Fantastic to see those peregrines then. From one top predator to another, let's go and have a look at our ospreys. And curious things have been going on there. One of the chicks has become very dominant and it's actually wrestling its sibling to the ground there. It looks a bit rough. And in fact, got a good slap in the face for its troubles. But it does seem to be getting most of the food here. And its brother or sister is not getting a lot. And curiously, even when the parent goes away, there's quite a surprising degree of aggression. Look at that. Look at that. Really quite nasty goings on in that nest. Really taking it out. And Chris, that's really quite unusual.
It is unusual in ospreys. I mean, we see this in other raptors where they go for the old Cain and Abel strategy where there's a big one that can survive off of the little one, but normally they're quite passive in ospreys' nests, to be honest with you. We'll have to keep an eye on that.
Yeah, very worrying.
Should we have a quick look at something on our live cameras? What should we go to? Can we go to our marsh cam? Because I tell you, I'm feeling the wind behind me. It's not looking as stormy as I thought it would be. And we've still got the 3 cygnets, I think, which is amazing and really good news. I think that's a good positive thing to end the show on. That's it from us for this week on Springwatch, at least. We'll be back on Monday. I'm sure plenty will be going on the webcam, so keep your eye on those over the weekend because I think some of our birds might be fledging. Some of them will be coping with the windy weather, especially our little gold crests. How will they cope if this wind really picks up?
And next week, we'll be catching up with the otters down here and dipping into their secret lives.
And as Michaela says, keep an eye on the red starts because there's a very good chance that they might fledge over the weekend and you'll see that before we do on Monday.
So we'll be back on Monday, but of course we will be back very shortly, well, in about a couple of minutes, with Springwatch Unsprung. We'll be answering lots of your questions. We're going to leave you for now with the live peregrines.